We have yet to enter a durable bull market. He's still finding pockets of opportunity and strong, quote, deep value plays. Joining me now, right here, Post 9, once again, Kevin Gordon, Charles Schwab. Welcome back.
Hey, Scott. Good to see you.
All right. So I'm looking at the notes. Now, participation from average stock lagging. Breadth not consistent with a strong, durable bull market. Constructive price action outside of the Magnificent Seven is lacking. Got to be cautious. We've been saying this for like 10 and a half months.
Well,
when does it not matter?
I will say some of it started to change in midsummer. And, you know, we started to get constructive when all that, as you just listed, started to improve. You had started to see breadth metrics participate. The average stock improved relative to the cap weighted index. Small caps started to get some legs of strength for a little bit.
No traction, really.
No traction, right? But that proved to be a head fake. And then July was kind of this turning point, obviously, in hindsight, because we know that that was the most recent peak. Mm-hmm. But also the fact that, you know, you really started to see, I think, more of a negative divergence within some of the earnings data, where even though earnings beat rates started to improve, sales beat rates started to roll over, you haven't really seen as much of a durable improvement as you move down the cap spectrum. So, you know, we're kind of back to this theme that we've been in for, you know, a couple of years now, which is just one of bifurcation, where now even in this latest advance from late October, you've had the mega caps leading the way. So the Magnificent Seven has been the group to be in, and then everything else has sort of been just lacking. I will say, you know, in terms of the advance and whether it's sustained, you do still have some support from a sentiment perspective. So, you know, for all of the excitement around the gains that you've had over the past couple of weeks, it hasn't really been met with a ton of investor enthusiasm, especially on the behavioral side.
It's not like we're miles away either from new highs, really.
Oh, yeah.
Which shows the resiliency of the market in the face of everything and the haters. I'm not necessarily putting you in the hater group, but, you know, the haters who say, well, the market doesn't look good, it's not healthy, it's being led by mega caps, it's just up the whole way.
Yeah, and it's not as much that, you know, just because it doesn't look good means it looks outright bad. If you were just to take out the mega caps, you're up slightly year to date. If you were just looking at the equal weighted S&P, you're flat year to date. So that's not terrible, but again, I think a lot of the discussion this year has been dominated by whether we're in a bull market, you know, a new bull market.
Oh, sure, and or just a bear market rally.
Yeah, and you can use the 20%
rule
if you want to. But I think that that's a little bit too simplistic. And it's too simplistic because when you look at prior major market lows, even in the case of a non-recessionary bear market, which, as far as we know, that was the case last year, everything that is supposed to do well in all the cases of recessionary, non-recessionary bear markets, whether it's small caps, whether it's banks, they just haven't done well at all.
Well, because overarching and overriding, in many respects, recession fear.
Oh, yeah.
People just can't get out of their mind that the Fed's done all of this work.
Yeah.
Well, of course it leads to a pretty good recession.
Yeah.
Well, maybe not.
Well, that's the tough part, because you've got this, what I think is the message from the market, it's going to dominate for a while, is just late cycle for longer, because you have still indicators, which we're turning a little bit this year, housing related, consumer confidence, CEO confidence, even CEO confidence around hiring trends, which started to improve and look like they were entering their own little rolling recoveries, because we've been calling these rolling recessions. Now those have rolled back over. So not back into dismal territory where everything is catastrophic, but keeping you sort of in that zone of, even if you were just looking at something like the ISM manufacturing PMI, not yet at a recession-like territory like you had in 2001 or 2008 to 2009, but still sub 50 and staying in that zone where you're just kind of muddling along in contractionary territory and there's not much going on. So I think that's what you have to look for, is whether that starts to turn, whether you get some strength from services and labor.
Where are the pockets then of opportunity that exist in an uncertain economic world versus an area where all the money has gone anyway already, so everybody knows about it?
Yeah. So as we think about, you know, where we're turning, not just into 2024 in the short term, maybe more on a secular basis, if we really are in more of a higher for longer environment, you really have to consider, which I know it's been the topic of conversation, at least on the show so far today, just the interest environment, where we're going in terms of rates. Mm-hmm. What companies can withstand higher interest expense and have the earnings to offset that? So it's not as much a sector play. It's much more of a factor or characteristic play, because you can find companies in every sector almost right now, whether it's energy, whether it's consumer discretionary, whether it's tech, that have high and rising interest coverage ratios, and that's the opportunity, I think. So if you're approaching this and you're more of a long-term oriented investor and you're approaching it from that standpoint, that to us makes a lot more sense, because it's just kind of the new normal, where rates have gone, the fact that the trend, the longer-term downtrend for yields has kind of broken. You know, for companies that haven't termed out debt, they're definitely struggling right now. But mm-hmm. even for those that have, you want to be up in quality.
What does a favorable CPI report tomorrow morning mean for the rest of the year?
I actually, just because of all the data we have this week and all the Fed speak we have this week, I'm not sure it matters
like
a whole lot.
Speakers.
There's literally 20 Fed speeches. So I think that, but in addition to, you've got PPI, you have home builder sentiment coming out, you've got retail sales, you have a lot more that's going to give you more of the context for the economic backdrop. So to me, that's much more important is the collection of data. But I think even if you were stepping back and taking a look at the landscape, the Fed is still in a position, and you know, I do think that the risks are getting more balanced and more two-sided, but the Fed is still in a position where they'd probably bias towards over-tightening rather than under-tightening. I think you could see that pretty clearly in the language. Even if there's not another hike on the table, the willingness to cut rates, even with inflation not back to target and the unemployment rate still relatively low when you look at history, I think that's still the bias, is to keep things in a tight and a restrictive position.
All right, good stuff. Good to see you again.